Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this learning objective video, we will be discussing the muscles of the posterior compartment of the forearm. So this will be a very similar format to how we discussed the anterior compartment, and there are even more muscles in the posterior compartment than the anterior, 11 in all. So again, we will go into the big picture concepts of this compartment with a particular emphasis on actions. As always, I like to start with generalizations. So there are only two layers in this compartment, in this posterior compartment, but more muscles per layer than what we saw in the anterior compartment. This compartment is also known as the extensor / supinator compartment, which gives you a general idea regarding the main actions, which include extension of joints of the wrist and hand, as well as one muscle playing a role in supination of the radio-ulnar joints. Now, what a really good thing here is that all of these muscles are innervated by the radial nerve and its branches. So we don't have to focus on any unique innervations here. And as I have said 100 times and will say 100 more, radial nerve equals posterior. Let's get into a bit more detail regarding the superficial layer. There are six muscles in this superficial layer, so a lot going on. There is my personal favorite, brachioradialis, which is our oddball in this region. This is not an extensor. Its muscle belly is seen on the anterior surface as well as the posterior, and its distal tendon doesn't even reach the wrist. But like all the other muscles here, it's innervated by the radial nerve, so it is included in this compartment. There are two extensor carpi radialis muscles. So there is the longus and the brevis. And so the longus and brevis indicates the length of each, and these will work together. We'll talk about that in a bit more detail. There is only one digitorum muscle, so there's only one extensor digitorum, so not a superficialis and profundus, so here is your digitorum here. There's an itty-bitty little muscle that is going to affect the fifth digit, so the digiti minimi, so the extensor digiti minimi. And it's really just an offshoot of the extensor digitorum. So not really going to go into too much detail regarding the digiti minimi muscle, even though it's got a fun name. And on the medial side, or the medial most side, there is one extensor carpi ulnaris. So no longus or brevis for the ulnaris, just the one. Four of the six muscles will share a proximal attachment on the lateral epicondyle of the humerus via the common extensor tendon. The other two, which are brachioradialis and the ECRL, will attach just a little proximal to the lateral epicondyle. People who repetitively use their superficial extensor muscles in, say, like tennis, if you think about the backhand, if they use this repetitively, they may feel pain over the lateral epicondyle region, as you can kind of see right here. Particularly, they feel the pain when they're opening a door or lifting a glass, so kind of in that extension movement. And this pain can be caused by micro tears in that common extensor tendon, or even inflammation of the periosteum of the lateral epicondyle. This is referred to as lateral epicondylitis, also referred to as elbow tendinitis, and colloquially it's referred to as tennis elbow because individuals that play tennis are more prone to this type of injury. Now, obviously, there are all kinds of distal attachments, but what I want to draw your attention to are those of the four long tendons of the extensor digitorum, which will flatten and form what are called extensor expansions. And sometimes you hear these referred to as dorsal expansions or dorsal hoods. These will wrap around the posterior portions and sides of the head of the metacarpals, as well as the proximal phalanges. So you can kind of see them on either side here. It'll serve to kind of tether down these tendons. There's one here too on the fifth digit. It's just showing you the bones here on this model. Some of the muscles we will discuss in the hand will also have attachment on these expansions, which will help us understand those actions. Sometimes it seems counterintuitive, but understanding where these extensor expansions are located will help give an indication of what's going on. So these will play a role with extending the digits of 2 through 5, particularly in terms of the interphalangeal joints. These extensor expansions and various ligaments throughout the posterior hand really give a very distinctive look to the posterior portion of the digits. So we'll come back to these extensor expansions when discussing the hand. Okay, in terms of actions of the muscles in the superficial layer, recall that that brachioradialis is the odd one out. It is a flexor. It's a flexor, so it is unique, and it will flex particularly that elbow joint. So synergistic inflection of the elbow joint. The extensor carpi muscles will extend the wrist, which is of particular importance in making a fist. So if you think about making a fist, a lot of times you need that very secure extension of the wrist. The carpi radialis muscles, so both the longus and the brevis, will also abduct or abduct the wrist. So if you think about your palm in anatomical position, that would have the hand moving away from the body. And the extensor carpi ulnaris, so in addition to the radialis muscles, will extend the wrist, and it will do the opposite action in regards to adduction, or kind of adding back the hand towards the body at the wrist joint. And as mentioned when we were talking about the extensor expansions, the extensor digitorum muscle will extend the digits, so at those interphalangeal joints. And specifically, I should have put this here, it will extend the digits of 2 through 5. The deep layer is an interesting one, as 3 of the 5 muscles will solely affect the first digit. And it makes sense. Your first digit or your thumb can do some complex movements, so you're going to have lots of muscles that play a role here. Additionally, these pollicis muscles will start deep and then pop through to a more superficial position. So here we're looking at a more superficial view of the forearm extensors. So there are all those muscles that we just talked about, but you can see in this distal portion, you can see those pollicis muscles kind of popping out and becoming a bit more superficial. These are sometimes called the outcropping muscles of the deep layer. All right, keeping on with the pollicis muscles, when you see pollicis, I want you to think first digit. Always think first, or the thumb. And these muscles are very fortunately named. They tell you exactly which action they play a role in. So the abductor pollicis longus will abduct the first digit. This action will specifically occur at the carpometacarpal first carpometacarpal joint. These are hard to say sometimes, so you kind of have to take your time and get that word out. These other two muscles, extensor pollicis longus and brevis, will extend the thumb through the various joints of the first digit. I always describe the action of extension of the thumb as like a hitchhiker's thumb. So kind of jutting it out towards the side, that's going to be extension of the thumb. And we'll talk a bit more about thumb movements when we talk about the hand, as they're going to be unique in terms of the plane in which they occur. There is a very small muscle called the extensor indicus. You can see a little bit of it right here. That serves a similar role to the extensor digitorum, but only to the second digit or the index finger. That's where the indicus comes from. This allows independent extension from the other digits. So while I kind of want you to be aware that this occurs, that this muscle is here, I don't want you to go into too much detail in terms of the extensor indices. Lastly, and more proximally located, you will have the supinator muscle, which, as you might guess, will cause supination of the radial ulnar joints, particularly supination in slow, unopposed supination. And do you remember what the other main muscle that causes supination to occur? I hope you remember it's the biceps brachii. Remember that biceps brachii in the anterior compartment of the arm. And biceps brachii is particularly important in terms of rapid or forceful supination against resistance. Excellent. We have made it to the summary slide. I always suggest you start your review with these generalizations. I think that's a good place to start always, and then you can kind of add in detail from there. And as you review, always feel free to reach out with any questions. Thanks for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.